Tyre pressure is one of the most important factors affecting the performance of your bike. I mean, it makes sense when you think about it, given that they are the only point of contact between you and the ground. But yet, I don't think all that many people really give tyre pressure that much thought. And actually, until very recently, virtually all of us were making a fairly fundamental mistake about it. Mainly that harder tyres roll faster. You might lose all sensation in your hands and your undercarriage, but damn, you sure go fast when there's 130 psi or 9 bar in your tyres. Except that's just not true. And we found that out because the cycling world has finally bothered to investigate. Slowly but surely, we're waking up to the fact that lower pressures can be faster, be that racers or everyday riders or engineers at companies like Zip, who are very much at the forefront of this. Actually, it's got to be said, cyclocross racers have known this for decades. So yes, you folks can look smug now. In this video, we're going to look closely at the subject. Are lower pressures genuinely faster and more efficient? And if lower is better, then how low should you go? To find out, I'm going to do a little experiment. I'm going to put a lot of time into this short section of road, riding it repeatedly with different pressures in my tyres. And I tell you what, I am delighted that I've chosen such a lovely day for this experiment. I'm also using this clever little gadget from Quark called a Tyre Whiz. So it's fitted on to the valve stem on my wheels, and it tells me in real time via an app exactly how much pressure is in my tyres. It's super accurate, apparently. Now, admittedly, real-time tyre pressure probably isn't something that many of us would find terribly useful all that often, but it's also got another function, which is that it can recommend a tyre pressure for you and then alert you when you're not running it. So just like in a modern car, I guess. So if this topic doesn't float your boat in the slightest and you're just here accidentally, having something like this on your bike would take the pressure off. Get it? Frankly, it's a good job that Zip have done the hard yards on this, because there is a lot to unpack on this subject. Factors affecting the optimal tyre pressure for you include your body weight, so larger riders will need to run higher pressures than smaller riders. Then there's your tyre width and your rim width. So lower volume, narrower tyres and rims will mean that you need to run a higher pressure. And then lastly, there's the surface that you're riding on. So smoother surfaces warrant higher pressures, whereas the rougher the surface, the lower you will need to go. Today, I'm using 28 millimeter wide tubeless tyres fitted onto Zip's hookless 303 Farcrest wheels, which are themselves really broad internally, 25 mil. Now, this high volume setup, probably a few years ago, would have been considered only appropriate for something like Paris-Roubaix or, I don't know, mountain biking, frankly. No, that is a joke. But this is now the kind of setup that's being used in the World Tour. So whilst it might seem quite wide to some of you, this is by and large what's being considered optimal for a lot of road conditions. And no, that's not just marketing. When teams like Ineos and Jumbo Visma and SD Works are running 28 mil wide tubeless tyres, you know that there's something behind it. Because frankly, winning the Tour de France or the Tour de France Fam is worth more than the marketing dollars that a bike company can contribute to the team. Anyway, I digress. Now, my weight at the minute is, I don't know, 70 something kilos, and the road that I've chosen to do my experiments on is chip and seal, the kind of tarmac that most of us ride on regularly. This is very aggressive chip and seal, I've got to say, as witnessed by the extent of poor Alex Payton's injuries. He sampled a piece of road literally 5 meters away with his hands, his elbows and his knees last summer. And whilst I wouldn't say they were like shark bites, he definitely looked like he'd been mauled by a bunch of piranhas. Hopefully, I'll stay rubber side down. Now, my test will involve me riding up and down my stretch of road using a set power. 250 watts, in fact. Up, I'll be travelling at around 22 kilometres per hour, and down, around 45 kilometres per hour. I'll keep my power the same and only vary the tyre pressure. Of course, the results could be influenced by wind, so I'll do a number of different test runs with the same pressure to try to offset that. Right, let's get on with it, shall we? I'm not getting any drier. Run number one, I'm gonna go with 72.5 PSI front and back. And the reason I'm going for that is because it's the maximum pressure that I can run with this setup, because I'm using hookless rims. And that maximum is dictated by the International Standard Organization, the ISO. Now, were I using 23 millimeter wide tires and inner tubes, that pressure would be exceedingly low. But as mentioned, with higher volume tires, you want to run lower pressure. So actually, this is nigh on rock hard with my body weight. And we've covered off why wider tyres can be faster and more efficient in a previous video, but in essence, wider tyres can generate lower rolling resistance. And that's because the shape of the contact patch that they make on the road is shorter and wider than with narrower tyres. And what that means is that the tyre then deforms less as it rolls, so more of your energy goes into moving you forward as opposed to being lost as heat as the tyre deforms in a process called hysteresis. It's not just about wider tires though. Wider internal rim widths can also reduce hysteretic loss because they too can change the shape of the tire. Now, in theory, to keep hysteretic loss at an absolute minimum, you'd want to run your tires as hard as possible so they don't deflect at all. And this is what we used to do, except you don't want to do that anymore. One of the benefits of running wider tires is that you can use lower pressures. But why do you want to do that? Well, that's what we're all here for, isn't it? We're gonna find out. Right, run one, done. Run number two. First run's done, an average time of 5 minutes, 41 seconds going up, plus or minus a couple of seconds, so pretty happy with that. And then an average of 1:49 coming back down again. Again, plus or minus a couple of seconds. So, pretty decent data, I think. Now, I'm gonna drop the pressure by 10 PSI front and back, so 62.5 I'll be running, which is kind of getting towards the ballpark where I would normally run, I think. So all I need now is a track pump lying around. Ah, there you go. Brilliant. Tire pressure number two coming up. So we reminded ourselves about the reasons for wider tires, but why these lower pressures then? The million-dollar question. Well, in addition to wind resistance and gravity and drivetrain friction and rolling resistance, another significant force that's slowing you down is vibration losses. And this, inexplicably, is the one that we never used to think about. Vibrations cause by riding over the road or the trail, slow you down. And Zip explained why very neatly in a white paper that they wrote to explain their total system efficiency concept, which is the thinking behind their new wider hookless rims and using 28 mil wide tires and bigger. So they say that vibration losses stem from forces impeding forward motion that are encountered by lifting the rider bike system over regular small bumps many times per second, in addition to energy loss through a damping response when the human body is shaken. So yes, those vibrations that you're feeling through your feet and your hands and your butt are also slowing you down because that energy is converted into heat in your body. So in essence, smoother is faster. We need to reduce the vibrations that we feel, and the best way of doing that is by lowering your tire pressure. So that is the reason. Now, it's still not feeling super smooth at this pressure, I'm not gonna lie, so my internal pressure sensor suggests that I maybe need to knock it down, maybe another 10 PSI, but we'll see about that. So I'm being a bit antisocial here, staring at my stem. Halfway point, was I faster? Yes, yes I was. 0.3 kilometers per hour faster on the way up and 0.4 kilometers per hour faster on the way back down. Now, given that the only thing I've done is lower my tire pressure, that kind of speed increase, whilst not huge, is still not to be sniffed at. Now, next, I'm gonna go lower still. I'm actually gonna use tire pressures that are recommended to me by SRAM's online tire pressure calculator. So a load of very smart people there have been geeking out on this subject for far longer than I have. They've done loads of research with different equipment setups, different body weights, different riding surfaces, and they've inputted it all into a database to create a tool that's free for anyone to use, and it's online, it's on their website. Now, with my parameters, it's suggesting 53.7 PSI up front and 57.1 PSI at the rear. The difference between the pressures between front and rear wheel is, of course, because you've got different amounts of body weight going through each wheel. So, hopefully, my track pump is still going to be somewhere in a hedge where I left it. Yes, there it is. Ah, the hedgerow pump. A familiar sight in Great Britain, alongside blackberries and slowberries and things like that. Slowberries? Slows. Anyway, you know what I mean. Here we go then. Let's see if SRAM's boffins know what they're talking about. So I could feel that it was smoother. Was it faster though? Yes, but only just 0.1 k an hour faster. So we're talking 3 or 4 seconds on average. So not very much. And definitely at that point where I start to feel a little bit uneasy about saying it's statistically significant, even on my fairly limited data set. But nevertheless, it's certainly not slower. What I'm going to do now is drop the pressure even further. What I want to see is whether or not we can drop the pressure to the point where actually it starts getting slower again. So where the rolling resistance is increased enough to offset any potential gains by reducing those vibration losses, effectively by riding on an airbed or something like that. So 42 and a half front and back, if my pump is still there. Yes, there it is. Ah. That is definitely soft. There's no two ways about it, but is it going to be fast? Comfortable, yes. Fast, we'll find out. Stay tuned. I tell you what, if comfort was my priority, I'd definitely be running 42 and a half PSI. These are pillowy, or at least they are going uphill. We'll wait to be seeing what they're like going downhill. So that is all the runs done now. The last one in particular, comfort, it's got to be said. It did feel a bit slower, which, I mean, we're talking about nuances here, fractions of nuances, in fact, but that's my honest opinion. Check the results. Quick bit of maths. Yes, okay, we are going slower again. So I might have been super comfortable, but I was going a little bit slower again. So not as slow as I was at 72 and a half, but still slower than I was at 53.7 and 57.1 or whatever. So, as I said, tyre pressure, there is an awful lot to unpack. I don't think we should do it here at the side of the road. Let's go find a coffee. Oh, and a track pump, hang on. There we go. Gonna be a long ride to the calf with this, isn't it? One of those days where it's good to get home, frankly. Mm. Now, as I said at the start, there is a lot to unpack with optimal tyre pressures. To help sum up, I found this graph really useful. So it was made by Zip, and it shows those two factors affecting optimal tyre pressure outside of body weight and the equipment that you're using. So you can see that with harder tyres, so higher pressures, you get lower rolling resistance, and then with softer tyres, so lower pressure, you get more vibration damping. And so at any point, your optimal pressure is the best compromise between the two. So on smooth roads, where there's less vibration, then higher pressures for the win. And on rougher roads and on dirt, those lower pressures will offset that increased rolling resistance and offset it by quite a long way. Actually, the amount of watts you can save on rough roads and on dirt trumps rolling resistance massively. Now, if you take this literally, and you search for your optimal tyre pressure, you'd literally be trying to change your tyre pressure every time the road surface changes. And I'm not suggesting that. Instead, I think if you've got half an interest in this subject, and I guess you have because you're still here watching this, then you should know what your ballpark ideal pressures are based on your weight and the equipment that you've got. And then you can fine tune the pressure based on the types of roads that you're riding and the road surfaces that you're on. From what I've seen today, based on the equipment that I'm using and the type of roads that I normally ride on, the type that eat Alex Paton's for breakfast, in fact, my optimal tyre pressure is somewhere between 50 and 60 PSI, as predicted, in fact, by that calculator. It's really important to note, though, that in order to run these kind of low pressures that I'm using today, you might find that you need to run wider tyres. As I said earlier, I was on 28s, but crucially, you might also need a wider rim to support it. Narrower rims make the tyre into more of a light bulb shape, so there's less support from the sidewalls, which means that it will feel different, it'll perform differently when there's less pressure in them, particularly when cornering. Now, as always, if the latest tech is out of reach for you, then don't worry about it, because what I'm saying today is just to recognize the importance of tire pressure on bike performance. Because no matter what equipment you have, it can always be optimized. Try that tire pressure calculator out. It takes into consideration tire width and type and rim width and type as well. Be really interested to know, do you think that you're running your tires too hard? Have you already experimented with going lower? And what is, in fact, your optimal tire pressure? Before we go, one quick point that often comes up. If your optimal tyre pressure exceeds that 72.5 PSI limit on hookless rims, what should you do? Well, Zip recommend going up a tyre size, so that increased volume will allow you to lower the pressure so you get all the benefits and you're still within that pressure limit. I would imagine this might provoke a bit of debate in the comments, this video, so get involved. I can't wait to read them all, and I'm gonna get stuck in myself as well. Thank you very much for watching. Give the video a big thumbs up if you've enjoyed it.